la parola.
Sì, va bene. Ok, allora andiamo in inglese. I was going to ask if we have people that do not understand Italian. If so, maybe you can write in the Q&A that you want me to go in English, because actually I don't see any more. No, there is a colleague probably that cannot speak Italian. Okay, let's go in English, so it's safe for everybody. So first of all, welcome. Thank you for joining us in this webinar, which is sponsored by the Italian Economic Society. Here, somebody's, yeah, thanks English. Okay, perfect. We were already going in English. Okay, right. So thank you very much for joining us today. It's a pleasure for us to have here with us today Mario Francesco Carillo and Tullio Iappelli, who are going to present a contribution which links pandemics and local economic growth, particularly with evidence from the great influenza in Italy. And I have to say that I was very happy to volunteer myself to chair this session because the title was very catchy, and I'm really interested in looking at the contribution that links the pandemics, especially the great influenza, with local economic growth, which is one of my interests. So the rules of the game are pretty easy. You'll have about 45 minutes to present. 40, 45 minutes, it's up to you. And then we will leave the last 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes for discussion. For the attendees, if you can type your questions at the end of the presentation or during the presentation, if you prefer, in the Q&A, then at the end, I can actually read them out. Or while I'm asking, actually, Mario, do you prefer to read them yourself? Do you prefer me to actually moderate and select and ask you the questions? Whatever you prefer.
Up to you, whatever you prefer.
Okay, so I can probably read them out maybe while you are presenting or you're finishing presenting, and I will act as a filter and ask you the question that we received in the Q&A at the end of your presentation. So thank you very much again for being with us, and the floor is yours, Mario.
Okay, thanks a lot, Alessandra, and thank you all for having me. It's a great pleasure. To be here and to present this work joined with Tullio Iappelli. Okay, so the COVID pandemic induced policymakers to take rapid decisions about which policy to undertake in order to contain the contagion and its consequences. And typically, these decisions are based on getting a sense of what are the effects of the pandemic and what are the effects of the intervention itself. And as a result of it, quantifying the economic effects of pandemics is key. However, one of the main difficulties in doing so is that typically policy interventions to contain the spread of the virus were implemented, and as a result of it, they may potentially confound the estimates. So what we do in this paper, we basically explore the consequences of the 1918 flu pandemic in the context of Italy. And the reason why we think that Italy is an interesting case is that there were very limited interventions to contain the spread of the virus. And as a result of it, Italy provides an environment which allows us to explore the economic consequences of a pandemic without the potentially confounding effects of policy interventions. Okay? So we'll be looking at the flu pandemic, which killed about 40 million people worldwide, and potentially even more, which would be about 2% of the world population at that time. And Italy, unfortunately, was one of the most affected countries in Europe, with about 600,000 people who died, and I'll tell you precisely how this number is calculated, which would be about 1.2% of the Italian population. So one of the reasons why Italy was so exposed to the virus was, as I said, the fact that there were very limited interventions to contain the contagion. Let me give an example. This is a poster from that time from the Comune di Milano, which gives us some precautions, some suggestions to minimize the spread of the virus. So I'm not going to read that to you, but what I want to emphasize is the date, which is top right here, which is October 1918. As I'll show you in a few slides, that was really the peak of mortality at that time. And so even, you know, so many people were dying, you know, institutions were just giving suggestions of what to do to minimize the virus rather than actually imposing lockdowns or other similar measures. And in addition, there was also very limited understanding of what was going on. In fact, this is an example from a commercial of that time in which the toothpaste is suggested as a way to treat the Spanish fever. So it comes as no surprise that so that you know the death toll was so high. So what do? We use regional variation in 1918, in mortality from the flu in 1918, and investigate its effects on economic growth and its effects on industrialization. And of course, we are not the first in studying the Spanish flu. There is a set of recent works studying the short, medium-run consequences of that pandemic across countries, Barro, or within countries, for instance, for the United States, Denmark, Sweden, and so on. And as I mentioned before, I think that Italy is an interesting case, which is you know, given the limited interventions that took place at that time. Also, there are parallel set of studies that emphasize the long-term effects of the Spanish flu. Typically, these are more at the micro level, like cohort-level studies for the United States, Italy, and so on, or income inequality within Italian municipalities, and so on and so forth. And then finally, there is a literature, there is a tradition to some extent in studying pandemics in Italy, but typically they have been focusing on the plague, which was much earlier in time. Okay, so let me give a very brief historical background. Okay, so in 1915, Italy joins the war up to 1918, and about 600,000 soldiers die. And then in the fall of 1918, so towards the end of the year, the influenza pandemic spreads within Italy. And then in the 1919 up to 21, there was a huge recession with a large drop in GDP per capita in 1919 and a cumulative decline of about 30% over 3 years. And several explanations have been emphasized in the literature, such as high public debt, inflation, social conflict, and so on and so forth. But to the best of our knowledge, no one has emphasized the role of the influenza pandemic, and that's what we do. Then in 22, Mussolini becomes prime minister. However, at the beginning, there were the laissez-faire years of the fascist government, which then became an actual dictatorship in 1925. So we'll make sure in our empirical analysis that the 1925 period and afterwards will not affect our results. Okay. And as I said, we explore flu mortality due to the influenza, and there are two main methodology to measure mortality. So one is simply to use the official mortality records, namely to count the number of deaths for influenza and pneumonia. So this is not it's simple, however, it's not perfect, of course, because it may not include people who died from influenza, but officially were registered as dying from different diseases. This is just an example why it's not a 100% perfect approach. However, it has the advantage, which is it's very simple, and there are no ad hoc decisions. And so we opted for this approach in light of its simplicity, and estimate a total of 562,000 deaths. An alternative approach is based on calculating excess mortality from any disease with respect to normal times. This is not perfect either, because it may include people that would have died anyway besides the pandemic, and that would overestimate the number. But perhaps the more complicated issue here, the main difficulty, is the choice of the normal time period, which is particularly hard in the context of Italy, given that Italy was in war in the years right before the pandemic. And in any case, studies that follow this approach estimate numbers in the order of 600,000 people, or up down to 450,000 people. And so you see, our numbers are more or less in the range of what is calculated with the alternative approach. So that makes that, you know, is reassuring for us that we are following the right direction. Okay, so this is a graph that we borrow from Ansart and co-author, which shows mortality in Italy by month. So on the x-axis, we have months, so we have time, and on the y-axis, we have mortality rate, so number of people who died over 10,000 people. So the main message of this graph is basically that for the context of Italy, most of the mortality was concentrated in 1918. So you see that the peak is actually at the very end of 1918. And so this really suggests that, given that mortality is concentrated in the last months of the year, this suggests that any economic effects of this shock will show up in the data in 1919. Okay? And that's precisely what we're going to find in the data. Okay, so this is to get a sense of the data we use. So this is mortality across Italian regions. So we see that there is quite a bit of variation. For instance, Marche is around 1%, and up to Apulia or Campania, which also gets to 1.9%. So there's a really like large variation across regions, and that's what we are gonna explore. Yeah, one other thing is that we do see a little bit of north-south gradient. Northern regions, such as Piedmont, Emilia, and so on, tend to have a lower mortality than regions from the south, with some notable exceptions, such as Sicily, for instance, which has fairly low mortality. So this could be for several reasons why there is this north-south gradient. Part of it, it could be due to climatic conditions or for economic reasons that we are going to explore in the data. So the main outcomes, so let me tell you a bit about the data. So the main outcomes that we use is growth of GDP per capita in the 16 Italian regions. So of course, we tie our hands in using 16 regions, with the advantage that we have yearly data, which allow us to use to explore short-term consequences of the shock. But we also explore share of labor in manufacturing from the census data, and also to validate our results with GDP. And then the variable of interest, as I mentioned, is 1918 flu mortality rate, which is basically the number of people who died due to influenza and pneumonia in 1918 over the total population in 1911. So why 1911? Well, that's simply because there were no other censuses, population censuses, taken in closer periods. And then the main control variables we use are sex ratio, because we know that there is some literature suggesting there could have been a gender biased effect. And we also take into account the share of people of specific age groups, which could have been more exposed to the spread of the virus. And then one important control that we have is World War I mortality rate, which is basically the number of military casualties over population in 1911. And that's an important control for us because, of course, Italy was in war, but more generally, of course, if the regions more exposed to World War I were the same regions more exposed to the influenza, that would be potentially problematic for us. Because it would be difficult to disentangle World War I mortality from the influenza mortality, right? But instead, actually, when we look at the relationship between these two variables, the relationship, if anything, is negative. So here on the x-axis, we have mortality rate for flu, and on the y-axis, we have World War I mortality rate, and we see that the relationship between these two variables is negative, which is good news for us. And also, I mean, despite the correlation, I mean, there is quite a bit of variation, one variable which is not explained from the other. For instance, look at Piedmont and Campania. They have very similar values in terms of World War I mortality rate, but very different values in the context of flu mortality rate. So there is quite a bit of variation to be explored. Okay, so just to have some descriptive evidence, we have as an outcome in column one, GDP per capita averaged over the pre-war years and its correlation with the flu mortality. And we see that as we would expect, the coefficient is negative, however, is not significant. And this really suggests that beyond economic forces, there could be also climatic variation that explains the extent of the exposure to the flu. In column two, we use GDP in 1913. And again, it's not statistically different from zero. And similarly, in column three, which we use share of labor in manufacturing in 1911. Column four, we explore the correlation with the World War I death rate that you just saw in the graph. In column five, we look at literacy, and the idea being that using that as an indicator of human capital. And in fact, as one would expect, there is in this context, a negative and significant coefficient here. It could be explained from different reasons, but in any case, this suggests that we have to control for initial conditions to make sure that they don't confound the estimates. Okay, so before digging into the empirical analysis, let me give an overview of what we expect in terms of theoretical prediction as a consequence of the Spanish flu. And so let me use just the canonical growth model. So let me show you this graph that summarizes the idea. So on the x-axis, we have capital per worker, and then we can plot any function of capital per worker. So we have two functions. This horizontal line is actually capital dilution. So it tells us the speed at which capital gets destroyed in the economy due to depreciation or population growth. And then this downward sloping curve is the saving function, so which tells us the speed at which new capital is accumulated in the economy. So the intersection between the two lines gives us the steady state, of course, and that tells us the equilibrium, which speed at which new capital is accumulated is the same at which capital gets diluted in the economy. Now, in the moment in which, so suppose we start from K0, okay, in the steady state, and then the influenza kicks in and it kills a large share of the labor force, what we would expect is that we jump to K1 simply because capital per worker increased. And as a result of it, the speed at which capital is diluted in the economy is above the level at which capital gets accumulated, which means that the growth rate of capital will turn negative. Okay? So we would expect a negative effect of the flu on the growth rate of the economy, which will then push the economy back to its steady state. So just to summarize, flu mortality would reduce the labor force, increase capital labor ratio above the steady state, which will then induce a reduction in the growth in capital per worker back to the steady state. And as a result of it, the flu would have had a negative and transitory effect on growth in income per capita. That's what the model, the standard growth model, would predict. Of course, there could be other mechanisms. Just to summarize some, you could have an effect on labor productivity, for instance, and that would also have a negative transitory effect on growth in income per capita, even though the structure of the model would move a little bit differently, but the prediction would be fairly similar. And also you could have other stories, such as an aggregate demand effect. For instance, it would decrease expected value of future income and dividends, and therefore reduce consumption and investment. Okay, so this is the overall theoretical prediction. And this is a preview of our results. So on the x-axis, we have flu mortality rate, and on the y-axis, we have growth in GDP per capita from 1919 up to 1924. And we see a negative relationship between these two, which is in line with the hypothesis. Now, of course, there are some extreme values. Typically, Veneto has a very low mortality rate. And so we make sure in the appendix of the paper that our results are not driven by these regions, such as Veneto nor Campania. Okay, so we estimate the following model. We have our outcome variable, which is growth in GDP, in the region I at time t. Then we have a constant, and we estimate this distributed lag model. So we have 10 leads and 10 lags of flu mortality. So this allows us to test not only the contemporaneous link between flu mortality and growth, but also whether this link takes place in the years after the shock, and as a placebo, if you wish, whether this effect took place even before the shock. So this beta S is a set of estimated coefficients, and our hypothesis is that there should be no link between flu mortality and growth before the pandemic, okay? And there should be a negative link between the two variables only after the year in which the shock takes place. So I'm gonna show you a plot of these betas over time. Okay, so this is what we find. The red line here is the year in which the shock takes place, which is 1918. So when we look at the coefficient from minus 10, for instance, this suggests that regions more or less exposed to the flu were growing more or less at the same rate 10 years before the shock. Okay, so that's the interpretation. And we see that these differential growth rates actually are fairly similar for the years before the shock up to the year minus 4, which is precisely the period in which the World War I takes place. So these fluctuations around the zero become more pronounced in the years of the war, and we make sure that our results are not driven by this window of the World War I period. Okay, then at time zero, the shock takes place, and the estimated coefficient become negative and significant precisely in the year after the shock, which is precisely what we would expect, given that the shock took place at the very end of 1918. And then what we see here is that this negative coefficient dissipates after about 3 years. So this is a very similar approach, but in regression table format. So we have from the sample that we employ here is from 1919 up to 24. So it's a very restricted sample period. And we have flu mortality in the 1 year lag, and that's the estimated coefficient that you saw before, which is in line with the hypothesis, negative and highly significant. Then in column two, we control for 111 death rate. And again, the coefficient remains negative and significant. Then in column three, we also control for initial level of GDP per capita. And our estimated coefficient barely changes in magnitude. And then in column four, we estimate the full set of lags, like four lags, and we see that basically the negative coefficient remains significant up to a third year lag, and then it becomes statistically indistinguishable from zero in the fourth year. So just to summarize this, to give a sense of the magnitude of the estimates, basically going from regions with low flu mortality, which would be around 1%, to regions with high flu mortality, about 1.5%, is associated with a reduction in economic growth of 6.5%. And this number is remarkably similar with other studies, in particular the Barrow and co-author study across countries. And the second main takeaway of our And the second main finding is that we find a transitory effect on economic growth, which is in line with the other studies, such as this one for Denmark. Okay, and then what we do next, we explore a wider sample. So we start from 1901 up to 1929, and therefore this allows us also to test for the contemporaneous effect of the flu mortality and growth. And basically what we see in column one, we see that also the contemporaneous effect is significant, and actually it's positive. However, it's very small in magnitude. And when we introduce any control, so in column two, we control for World War I death rate, actually the coefficient from the contemporaneous effects vanishes. And that's precisely what you would expect. Of course, given what we saw, that the effect will show up the year later. And then we see that the effect is negative and significant with 1 year lag, and it lasts for about 3 years. In column three, we control again for initial conditions. And then in column four, we control for time trend. And in column five, we introduce regional fixed effects. And what is interesting is that between column four and five is that even though we introduce regional fixed effects, the coefficients barely change. So this really suggests that our estimates are not driven by some unobserved heterogeneity. Okay. So after World War I, Italy was still a predominantly rural society, and a large share of the labor force was employed in agriculture, with less than a third of the population living in municipalities with more than 20,000 inhabitants. So a very low degree of urbanization. And the interwar period is a period of industrial growth. And it's a period in which industrial output overtook agricultural output. And so, the process of industrialization was important to explain regional development and regional development differentials within the country. And as a result of it, we investigate the link between the flu pandemic and industrial employment over the years 1921, 31, and 36. So this is simply because those are the years in which the census, the industry census, were taken. So we explore a specification very similar to the one that we saw before. And in column one, we have, again, a negative coefficient, which is what we would expect. However, this coefficient is not very large in magnitude. We also control for one mortality, of course, and regional fixed effects. In column two, we introduce one period lag. And in column three, we introduce an additional lag. So, and then in column four, we introduce time trend. So what we find overall is that we do find a negative and statistically significant coefficient. However, in terms of magnitude, that's relatively small and it won't last long. Namely, we don't find a long-lasting effect on the spatial distribution of the manufacturing employment across regions. Okay, so let me conclude. So overall, our findings on the economic consequences of the flu, we find a negative effect on per capita GDP growth of about minus 6.5%, which lasted about 3 years. And as I said, this we find a small and negative effect on industrial development, which is not very long lasting. And therefore our interpretation is that, given that in the context of Italy, there were very limited policy measures to contain the pandemic, along with the fact that the mortality for the flu was very high in the less developed regions of the country, suggests that our estimates provide an upper bound of the adverse effect of pandemics on economic growth, which hopefully may shed light on the effects of pandemics in context of less developed areas of the globe. So with this, I think I conclude. So if there are any questions.
Thank you very much, Mario. Thank you. Very interesting presentation. I have to say extremely clear. So it was really, a very good presentation. Before I actually go to the questions, if we have any, I can share my thoughts while you were presenting. First of all, I think you are giving us some very good news in the sense that if the COVID has anything to do and is similar to the pandemic, then, you showed that the effect is basically 3 years, kind of short-lived. And so we hope that the same applies this time. And also, this is kind of for fun, but you showed the newspaper cut and it was October 14th. And you said over and over again that October was the peak, was the worst month. So, we hope that that's the case, because if that's the case this time as well, then we will be out of the woods in about 1 month, even though you never know what's going to happen. Very nice results. I really liked your model. And let me say that the one comment I had when you presented your first results, not the second slide, but the first one, as a regional economist, immediately I thought about regional fixed effects. So I think that for me, the most surprising result you showed was that when you put regional fixed effect in, you get exactly the same coefficient. It's hardly any different. And for me, regional fixed effect normally, especially in Italy, are important for a lot of things, right? Because of all these, as you said, unobservable that we don't maybe have data on. So it was really impressive. I was really impressed that when you put regional fixed effect in it, your model basically didn't change at all. So let me go and ask if anybody has any question. Okay. So there is a question in the Q&A from Tancredi Buscemi. So I'm going to read it to you. Good evening. I have a question. There are several factors that affected the Italian economy after the end of World War I. For instance, high unemployment rate within veterans who came back, probably a collapse in heavy industrial investments due to the end of the war, and several strikes in the more productive areas of the country, which surely affected the growth rate. Maybe it's proper to try to control for these factors?
Yeah, it's a good question, and of course there were many things going on at that time. So in trying to control for the exposure to World War One, what we do is in fact to take into account World War One mortality and the number of military casualties associated with war, and also that's our idea with that approach is precisely to take into account exposure to the war. Now, of course, there are always many things going on in a given period, and the idea is as long as these other shocks are not correlated with the exposure to the flu mortality, we should be on safe ground. So that's our identification assumption. So we don't have specific reasons to believe that other shocks are correlated with that. But overall, we are aware of the fact that, and as I showed, the regions more exposed to the disease were the poorer regions of the country. And as a result, we do take, so that's what I write here, is the fact is that our estimates provide the upper bound of the negative effect of the pandemic. So that's precisely, so if anything, this bias that would be induced by this unobserved heterogeneity will make our estimate an upper bound. That's the idea.
Thank you very much. Anybody else has question? Otherwise, I have a couple of curiosity that I can actually raise, but I don't know if Alberto wants to say something, or shall I go ahead and propose my curiosities and comments?
I have just one question. Actually, your evidence is about the effect of mortality related to pandemic, while in this case, we have other consequences, possible consequences related to lockdown and other social measures. In order to understand the role of mortality per se, how this type of mortality is related to pandemic, how this effect is different from any other type for any reason increasing mortality. For example, if you give a look to the rate of mortality due to World War One, but of course in the year, what happens is completely different. Is a mortality or is it the pandemic effect? It's not clear to me if you capture a mortality effect or a pandemic effect.
This is a very good question. We have been thinking about this. In fact, so the idea is the following. The pandemic would have at least two effects. So let's keep the policy part, from the side for a second. So the pandemic itself would have two effects. One is mortality, and the other one is contagion. So the contagion itself could have an effect on somehow, for instance, influencing productivity. Okay, so you have fear of contagion also will have an effect, right? So we don't measure contagion. However, to the extent in which contagion is positively correlated with our measure of mortality, namely when you have larger deaths, you also have a higher probability of get the virus. As a result of it,
if you have another example, if you find in the history or in some way another example in which you have an increase in mortality without contagion, because I don't know, earthquake or any other event that can increase mortality without this pandemic effect. You could try to, in a way, understand if the contagion that, of course, is correlated to mortality in the case of flu, of the Spanish flu, is relevant or is just a matter of mortality, or if the pandemic environment per se is especially important for understanding the decrease, the drop in the GDP growth.
Yeah, so we do believe that given that these two elements, so contagion and mortality, are positively correlated, our estimates are picking up both effects combined. So that's what we think. And in fact, that's part of the reason why pandemics can be so disruptive in terms of economic activity. But there are studies who look at mortality per se in other contexts, and also mortality, of course, per se has a negative effect. In the context of our measures, we don't want to take a stand for World War I death rate, because the regions that were more exposed to more mortality were also the richest regions of the country, and the ones that were growing faster. However, if we want to look at this lingua slide somewhere, Adam? Okay, so I have it here. For instance, in column 4, we do see a negative coefficient. Now, we don't want to take a stand that's causal, because as I said, exposure to World War I death rate was not linked to climatic conditions. But the coefficient is negative, and it's much smaller in magnitude. So if we want to take these coefficients seriously, that would be precisely in line with what you say. Namely, mortality per se has an effect, but on the top of it, you have additional effects due, for instance, to contagion, fear of contagion, and its potential effects on productivity.
Okay, thanks.
It's a very good point. Thank you.
If there are no questions, then I'm gonna abuse of my power, and actually I have two curiosity and one question. So I'm gonna just use the power I have because I found the presentation extremely stimulating. Okay, so nobody's asking questions. We have a very shy audience tonight, so I'm actually taking advantage of this. Okay, so here are my two curiosity. Of course, it's impossible not to compare the flu with COVID. You know, we have been living and breathing the COVID for the past few months. And so obviously I'm comparing the two. Do you know if there was any gender effect in the mortality rate? This is a curiosity, in the mortality rate of the flu, like in COVID, or women and men were actually dying at the same rate? Is there any statistics on that?
It's a good question. I think there are contrasting hypotheses between historians. Remember, if we look, so in our case, we cannot distinguish whether that, because in our data, we don't know whether that person is male or female.
Okay.
We cannot do that. We cannot do that with our data. Historically, we have read though that females were more exposed, if I'm not mistaken. Tullio, am I right? So
maybe even the opposite of what's happening today.
No, Mario is right. So good afternoon.
Hi.
He's right. So Alessandra, the pandemic was the influenza in 1918 was very different than today. It was predominantly the young, between age 20 and 35 or 40, say working age, who were affected and died. And also there was a gender bias. So one explanation it was advanced is because women were more, especially in rural areas, you know, assisting the elderly, and so they were more exposed to the contagion. But this is just one explanation. Right? But from the medical point of view, say in the medical literature, it's not clear why women were more affected than men. I mean, there are no, studies stating it from a medical point of view. The other thing, Mario, is maybe just to go back to Alberto's question to show again the picture with the mortality, the world mortality rate, and the influenza rate, which are, was at the beginning.
You mean this one?
Yeah. So you see, Alberto, they are not positively correlated. I mean, it's not that this influenza mortality sort of capturing or correlated with what more mortality. For instance, say take Veneto as one of the highest World War I mortality rate, because you know Veneto was at the border of the Austro-Hungarian state, and was more exposed, so to speak, to World War I, but less exposed to the pandemic. The other thing I wanted to stress is that another big difference between the influenza, I mean, this is of course not our we're not historians, but one big difference between today and 100 years ago is information. Mm-hmm. So the entire rhetoric in September and October of 1918 was about the war and the enemy that we were going to win against the Austro-Hungarian government, and any information about even the medical conditions within the countries were supposed to give you know, valuable information to the enemy. So they were not disclosed, or they were disclosed very late on, you know, at the end of September or initial beginning of October. And it was also not a big topic, so to speak, in the country at the time, because you know that the formal victories November 4 and even the 2 weeks before November 4 were the weeks right before the victory in World War I. And that was the same month in which the influenza peaked. So all the attention of the, you know, the media at the time, the public officials and so forth, was for the war and not for the war against the influenza. So this today instead is completely, of course, the opposite situation, in which there is a lot of attention about the influenza and perhaps over attention, someone might say, or possibly with respect to other economic or political problems.
Sure. I also have another, again, this is my second curiosity. So I've done a lot of work on human capital, migration and stuff like that. So when you mentioned the literacy as a proxy for human capital, absolutely fine. And then the correlation between the two was actually very, very strong. I mean, I've noticed that. And you said there might be a lot of different reasons for these. And I was just wondering, okay, so is it because these people with lower human capital were also poorer? Is it mediated via income? Is it because they could do something, but they didn't have the information or the ability to do something, and maybe they didn't get the cure? Is it something as simple as that? Or are you thinking of different mechanisms for this strong, very strong relationship?
Yeah, it's a good question. In fact, what we have read in historical literature is that actually, in regions where there were not enough doctors, people were more exposed to the virus simply because they were not, you know, they couldn't talk to someone who could help them with their choosing the right treatment. And so that could be one very simple reason why, you know, human capital, because you know, at the regional level, right? So that's an average at the regional level, would be correlated with the spread of the virus. That could be one reason. And of course, another reason could be human capital in a broader sense, in the sense of health. And of course, that would also be like pre-existing health conditions would also be correlated with the likelihood of getting the disease and dying from it. So that's also another mechanism that could be working. That's why it's so important for us to control for initial conditions, as you also mentioned, the regional fixed effects and so on are precisely there to take this particular, you know, initial conditions into account.
And my last question actually comes because now I'm writing a paper with two colleagues of mine here at GCSI, and of course we are using the data that we have now on COVID, and we are using excess mortality. And so you were very convincing of the reasons why you were using just death and not excess mortality. But I was going to push you a little bit more and ask you, but are you planning at some point to actually do a robustness check to see if with the data, well, first of all, can you get this data on excess mortality? Because you, if you can't, well, the answer is no, and we finish here. But is there a way that you could do a robustness check with the data on excess mortality? And I'm explaining to you why. You showed it very convincingly that at the end, the overall number is pretty much the same. But again, I always have this bias on space and kind of variation over space. And what we find with excess mortality is that at least for COVID nowadays, it varies a lot. And there was a certain point for a municipality, we got an excess mortality, which was actually negative. And I was like, how is that possible? That and they explained to me that it's because during the lockdown, people were not driving and you know, there was no accident, which of course I won't mention what area was this, but it made me think about this a little bit more, right? People maybe were not very good drivers in this area or whatever. So for them, staying at home, despite the COVID, was a good thing. And so I don't know. I really don't know if the regional composition might be different or if they are similar. And so this is just a useless thing. But I was just wondering if you're planning to maybe check on that and if you can.
It can be done, of course. There is an infinite number of robustness checks that can be done, of course. The reason why we haven't taken that route is simply because, as I think I explained somewhere here, so we have this issue of deciding what the normal times would be. So what the benchmark here would be. Because think about the following. So the flu kicks in 1918, which is a war year. So we will have to pick, so ideally one would take as a benchmark here, the year right before that, but that's again a war year. So what should we take as a benchmark here? It would be very problematic. So then we could go much, you know, back in time, like going before the war, but then it would be, you know, some sort of ad hoc decision because we were going, you know, the earlier you go, the less representative the benchmark here is. And so this doesn't, you know, make us comfortable. So that's why we decided to go for the simpler and it seems like representative from this, at least aggregate analysis exercise, approach.
I totally understand that, but I was just wondering if you take like the 10 years before the war, and you see that there hasn't been very much variation in these 10 years before the war, that is telling you that it was pretty much stable. I don't know if it is. I'm not a demographer, so I don't know. But if you don't have a lot of variation over the years, and maybe you take an average or something, because we actually took an average of, I don't remember if it was 2 or 3 years before, just cutting off this four-year period. But I'm not suggesting it's the right thing to do, but this is what my thought was actually.
Yeah, so you suggest to use as a benchmark here an average before the war, for instance?
See, first seeing if there is a lot of variation. So say, take, I don't know, maybe that's the stupid idea, I don't know, but like for 1900 to 1910. And you see that pretty much the mortality doesn't vary very much, then it's pretty stable.
But then war kicks in, right? And then this stability is not there anymore. I think this instability, let's say, over time, also includes 1918, which is the flu year. So, you know, not clear whether the normal good benchmark for the war time and vice versa. So that's the only reason. But yeah, I mean, it's something that...
I've actually exhausted my questions, so I don't know if there is anybody else who wants to ask a question before I actually close the session, but not before thanking our presenter. I think they're gracing you today, Mario. Nobody is asking questions. You were extremely clear. So it's always a little bit more difficult to actually ask questions when everything is so clear as you presented it. But anyway, let me thank Mario for presenting his work today and Tullio for being here with us and co-author of this paper. Oops, what? Somebody. Oh, Thank you very much. Sorry, it's just a thank you, but you can read that too. Okay, so I was very happy to be chair of this session. Thank you very much for being with us today. And I don't know if Alberto wants to say a thank you word as well before I actually close the session.
Thank you very much. I think that this is the last webinar before our conference next in the 23 of October. Then we have two more webinars in November, and then we are planning